All right, everyone, if you could please find your seats. We have now come at the end of 2.5 days to the last event of the 2014 Center for Ethics and Culture Fall Conference. And before we begin our conversation, I'd like to just thank everyone again. First of all, thank you all for coming and for your attention and for your friendship and your conversation. It's a wonderful, wonderful opportunity to have you here. We're delighted. Also to thank again the people that made this event possible. Harriet Baldwin and her staff, our benefactors, the Nicola family, the Mays family, as well as the staff of the Center for Ethics and Culture. Ryan Madison, my terrific associate director, Stephen Ferdoso, our communications and marketing coordinator, Deb McGuigan, our event planner, program manager, and pro-life program coordinator, Margaret Cabanis, publication assistant and editor, Tracy Westlake, our administrative assistant, Laura Nash, our medical ethics intern, along with all of our wonderful Soren fellows, our undergraduate and graduate student fellows who participate in the work and life of the center. Thank you for your work as well. Oh,
bravo, bravo, bravo.
Thank you very much. It's very kind. It's a pleasure. It's my pleasure. Okay, so the last event of the fall conference, as we sort of began this tradition last year with our, it's meant to be a more freewheeling, open-ended, free-form debate and discussion of a hot-button question, a vexed matter of ethics and public policy. Last year we talked about marriage. It's not a serial presentation of academic papers as we had throughout the previous sessions of the conference. It's meant to be fun. It's meant to be engaging. And what we have are four highly thoughtful and accomplished individuals who, broadly speaking, agree with one another, but may have differences of opinion. We'll find out on the question under consideration this evening, which is whether or not Catholic social teaching is compatible with, either in principle or in practice, with American capitalism. And as you all know, thinkers in the church, including popes, have said different things, some positive, some neutral, some quite negative, about free markets and capitalism. In fact, we have Father Matteo Liberatore, S.J., in 1891 wrote that free competition is a terrible weapon, most effectual to crush the weak and reduce whole populations to economic slavery under a rod of iron wielded by the potent rules of social wealth. So we'll count him as a critic of free markets. But Pope John 23rd, Pope Paul VI, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, Pope John Paul II, obviously Pope Benedict, and of course Pope Francis, Cardinal Dolan, prominent Catholic public figures, Paul Ryan, we heard from John Carr yesterday, take divergent views and many different positions on capitalism and how it's practiced in America, and also how American capitalism in the context of our nation and this, our structure of government have disagreed with one another. And we're going to have conversation about this this evening. So let me briefly, I mean, these are folks that don't really need introductions, but I'll do it anyway. First of all, we're going to hear from Patrick Deneen, my very good friend and colleague. Patrick is the Potenziani Memorial Associate Professor of Constitutional Studies here at Notre Dame. We were gratified to be able to steal him from Georgetown a couple of years ago, my alma mater, Georgetown. I'm glad we're both here. He holds a BA in English Literature and a PhD in Political Science from Rutgers University. From 95 to 97, he was a speechwriter and special advisor to the director of the U.S. Information Agency. From 97 to 2005, he was assistant professor of government at Princeton University. And from 2005 to 2012, he was an associate professor of government at Georgetown before he joined our faculty here in the fall of 2012. To my right, we have John Tomasi. He's the Romeo Elton Professor of Natural Philosophy, where he teaches, among other things, political science and philosophy at Brown University, where he's twice been awarded university prizes for excellence in undergraduate teaching. He's the founding director of the Political Theory Project, an independent research center at Brown that supports scholarship and encourages political dialogue on campus. He also holds an appointment at the University of Arizona's Center for Philosophy of Freedom, where he is the University Associate of Research professor. He received his BA from Colby College, but before that attended St. John's College, my other alma mater, and we're delighted to have him here. Also the alma mater of our associate director and of one of our speakers, Abe Scherner. But he didn't graduate from there. He, sadly, it was too hard for him, so he had to go to Colby College instead. And then he also did his graduate work in political philosophy at Arizona and Oxford University, where he got his BPhil and his DPhil. He's held positions at the University Center for Human Values at Princeton, Department of Philosophy at Stanford, and the Safra Center for Ethics at Harvard. In addition to his numerous scholarly articles, he's the author of Liberalism Beyond Justice and Free Market Fairness. To my left is James Mumford. He is the Nicholas Wolstersdorf Postdoc Research Fellow at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Culture at the University of Virginia. He earned his PhD from Oxford in Ethics and Religion, published in 2013 as Ethics at the Beginning of Life, a Phenomenological Critique by Oxford University Press. His research interests include bioethics, political theology, and modern Catholic social thought. Mumford was an undergraduate at Oxford and a Henry Fellow at Yale. From 2010 to 2013, he worked for a leading British political social policy think tank, the Center for Social Justice. He writes on a wide range of ethical, political, and social issues for a variety of publications, including The Guardian, Daily Telegraph, Demos Quarterly, The Huffington Post, The Spectator, The Hedgehog Review, and The American Conservative, as well as Standpoint. Now, as I said, our practice starting last year was to have a conversation among Catholics. We're talking about American capitalism, Catholicism. Jim here is our non-American, non-Catholic, but sympathetic outside observer, and we're delighted to have him join us this evening. Give us a little perspective. Make sure we don't become too parochial. Finally, my friend Hadley Arkes. He's the Edward Ney Professor in American Institutions at Amherst College and one of the country's most prominent proponents of natural law jurisprudence. He received a BA degree at the University of Illinois and his doctorate from the University of Chicago, where he was a student of Leo Strauss. He's the founder and director of the James Wilson Institute on Natural Rights and the American Founding, as well as the author of numerous books, including First Things, from which the journal took its name, Natural Rights and the Right to Choose. And I don't want to embarrass him, but his writing has drawn people towards the pro-life position in a way like no other's writing has, and we're grateful to him for that. His latest is a collection of essays called Constitutional Illusions and Anchoring Truth, the Touchstone of the Natural Law. Now, the format this evening is we're going to have brief 10-minute or ish opening statements from our speakers, and then we're just going to have at it and have a conversation. I will referee and perhaps contribute a little bit. So without further ado, let's begin with my dear friend Patrick Deneen.
Is this on? Okay, great. Thank you, Carter. Thank you, the Center, for what has been a real extraordinary last few days, and for the opportunity to be on the big stage here tonight against Notre Dame football, which is what everyone wants to be at an event against Notre Dame playing somebody like Navy. I think I'm on the panel to play the part of a critic of the of American capitalism from the standpoint of Catholic social teaching. So let me play that part and begin by saying that too often people who raise questions and are critical of American capitalism are automatically categorized as Marxists. This is a profoundly American set of categories. If you're not a supporter of capitalism, ergo you are a Marxist.
But Patrick is a Marxist, just to be clear.
Well, I do admire Karl Marx. No, wait, Groucho Marx.
They've been Reinhardt.
Groucho
Marx, Cardinal. Yeah. Okay.
Cardinal Marx.
Cardinal Marx.
So let me begin by stating the following. I am not against private property, markets, profits, lending, debt. I am not against any of these things. I am not a critic of these things. What I am against and criticize is all the ways that these phenomena are animated and organized by American capitalism, how they are given life in some ways, how they are manifested in the context of American capitalism, and in particular the way they are animated more deeply by the anthropology that's drawn broadly from the liberal, the modern, I don't mean the Michael Dukakis liberalism, but by the liberal tradition, beginning with philosophers like John Locke. We've heard, and I've been on a number of panels this weekend, where the language and indeed the philosophy of personalism has been invoked as a deep-seated understanding of the human person in the context of a intersubjectivity, a person formed in and through a web of relationships, and indeed a person formed in and through debt, one way in which I do support debt as our
homily tonight talked about, and the quotes from G.K. Chesterton quite aptly talked about the way in which we are all born debtors. What I am a critic of is the way in which the contemporary economy, in some respects, you could say, is premised on the exact opposite of personalism. And I would even go so far as to say that it is a philosophy of impersonalism. It's a philosophy that seeks everywhere and anywhere to create sets of structural separations, to impersonalize as much as possible and to anonymize as much as possible human relationships, human connections, human bonds, debts, gratitude, etc. We could say, to add a word to Alistair McIntyre's presentation, that we live in the context of organized heedlessness. Not simply heedlessness, but organized and structural heedlessness that is the intended result of a set of philosophical, anthropological, sociological, economic, and political understandings of the human person. These sets of organized forms of structural separation seek to separate the worker from the product, the consumer from production, the owner from the worker, capital from place, debtors from creditors. In every instance, the effort is to create anonymous and largely heedless forms of interaction that are largely abstract and deracinated, with the intended and indeed the result of greater gains in efficiency, fungibility, homogeneity, and above all, the release from the interpersonal, the liberation from the deeply embedded reality and experience of interpersonal indebtedness and forms of interpersonal relationship. In other words, what it profoundly succeeds at doing is individuating human beings from deeply seated contexts. This allows for, I would submit, the most desired separation that lies at the heart of the ideology of liberalism and its economic manifestation of capitalism, which is the release of the strong from the weak, and in particular, the economically strong from the economically weak. The desired ambition, as it's stated by John Locke in Book 5, or Chapter 5 of the Second Treatise of Government, is to separate the rational and industrious from the quarrelsome and contentious, what Rush Limbaugh would call Republicans from Democrats. This is the intended result that allows these particular forms of our personal talents or vocations to be manifest in a kind of extreme and pure way. This separation is systematized and perfected through an organized and structured set of institutions that are transformed in order to allow the salience and indeed the manifestation of the industrious and the rational within the economic system to be differentiated from the querulous and contention. And if nothing else, one simply has to look at our university and education system to see that this is the case, which are now almost exclusively organized with separating and sifting those who will be rational and industrious from those who are quarrelsome and contentious. That our institutions, particularly of higher education and our elite institutions, are designed to identify, locate, extract, refine, and then launch into the economic system those people who become the winners in our economic system. This system is becoming increasingly perfected, and we are seeing the result in many of the topics we've been discussing this weekend, the increasing differentiation of the strong from the weak, the rich from the poor. That's becoming a hallmark feature of our modern economy. One of the other results, and indeed the desired results of this form of organization, is that by extracting individuals from settings in which one, in some ways, is required not to be heedless, in which one is required to be thoughtful, is one also has to separate thoughtfulness from the doing of the things that once might have been done in the economy. We outsource care and thoughtfulness now to another entity that we call the government or the state. The state takes over the function of care or paying heed. We are released from the requirement to do so. And indeed, we could say that we pay taxes, and those who are most supportive of paying the taxes to support those who are not the economic winners tend to be the economic winners. Right? Why is it that those who are most successful in our major metropolitan areas are the most supportive of redistributive policies? Well, it tends to be because this is the price that's paid for their release from having to be involved in heedful relationships. So we outsource care to another impersonal entity or mechanism, the state. And this is not simply because the state becomes an opposition to the market, but it becomes the way in which the market itself perfects itself in the ways in which I'm talking about, so that social justice itself becomes outsourced to another impersonal mechanism. Thus, the strong not only then are empowered through this system, but what we're seeing increasingly is the more perfect separation of the strong from the weak that is now not only a manifested in our economic system, but is increasingly becoming a geographic fact in this country, and I would argue is a kind of logic we might see play out around the world, that not only are the strong now separated from the weak in terms of their success in the economic system, but they are literally geographically separated, living in completely different places, again, often extracted from the places they might have been born, being refined at institutions like this one, and then sent off to live at one of five cities and eventually the suburbs of those cities around the country. And if you want some evidence of this, just pick up the book Coming Apart by Charles Murray, who I think offers a really extraordinary analysis of this. But perhaps the most perfected form of this we see coming into being in a set of prophecies or predictions that have been offered as in the near future by an economist at George Mason University in a recently published book called Average is Over, the economist Tyler Cowen at George Mason University. And at the end of this book, Tyler Cowen looks at a set of trends, or in the course of the book, he looks at a set of trends that will have enormous impacts and are already having enormous impacts on labor markets, on the kinds of jobs that people are likely to have, and makes the argument essentially that average is over. The middle class is over. That the idea that you could have a middle class existence in this economy is coming to an end. You will either, he argues, be one of the 10 to 15% of the economic winners in this system, or you will be one of the 85 to 90% of the economic losers in this system. And there will be nothing in between these two. If you are one of the 85 to 90% of the economic winners, he says you will lead a scintillating, exciting, and interesting life. If you are one of the 85 to 90% of the economic losers, you will live in the equivalent of favelas in Texas, he argues. Texas in particular because it's a place of cheap housing and a lot of service jobs with subpar social services. And he says that this will be a future, perhaps a somewhat grim future, but alleviated by the fact that the 85 to 90% will have access to free internet. And so it will actually be it will be the simulacra of an interesting and exciting existence. So they have that going for them. And Tyler Cowen ends by saying that this is in fact, in some ways, perhaps the manifestation of the dream all along that Karl Marx had for the utopia of the workers, of the working class, except that it's capitalism that will bring this into the existence. And this will bring on the new golden age of people who have free porn as far as the eye can see. Well, I find this vision to be particularly not appealing, even though, you know, maybe teaching at a place like this puts me in one of the 10 to 15%. And I would submit that those of us who are Catholic Christians or any kind of person who is drawn to an understanding which we can't be heedless, we have to be involved, not just in theory and not just in outsourcing, but actually personally involved in the lives and the fates of others, that this is a fate that we ought not to greet or to welcome with acquiescence. And so finally, I would submit that if this is the course of American capitalism, this is a course that Catholics, Christians, and others really simply cannot brook. And we must work diligently and think very hard about how we would prevent that from happening.
Thank you, Patrick. John.
May I respond to that?
Yes, of course. You do whatever you want.
I will, maybe in the course of the...
Is your mic on?
I don't know. Am I on?
Did you switch it on? Oh, there it is. Yeah, it's on there.
Thanks. So first, thanks.
It doesn't appear to be on.
Am I on?
Can you hear, John? Raise your hand in the back if you...
One, two, three.
No?
One, two...
Very echoey.
Oh, sorry. I don't know what you're doing. Is that okay?
Really?
Here you go. Can you just hold that?
Is it okay? This is like the oxygen on an airplane.
It's just yourself first.
So first, I want to thank you all for coming instead of watching the Notre Dame game. I also am really grateful to Carter, to the Center for Ethics and Culture, and for Notre Dame for putting on a conference on poverty where Catholic perspectives are made central. It's really special that this happens, this kind of thing happens here. I had a chance to meet with your dean yesterday, and I told him how when I walked into my room in the Morris Inn, the first thing I saw on the wall, like right in my face, was a crucifix. Having taught at Brown for 20 years, I'm not used to that kind of thing. And it made me feel immediately at home. And just to all of you who teach at Notre Dame, or who study at Notre Dame, or who work at Notre Dame, or who come to events at Notre Dame from surrounding colleges, I just hope you're aware of how special and how vital it is what goes on here. So this is the last session, and it's getting dark outside. So I decided, there's something I want to tell you about capitalism and the Catholic tradition, but I've decided to begin with a bedtime story. So it's a secular bedtime story, but relax, here it is. Once upon a time, there was a great quarrel in the kingdom of secular political philosophy. On one side of this divided court was a great knight named John Rawls, who in 1971 wrote a book, 587 pages, called A Theory of Justice, which was a great defense of social justice and a great critique of the free market. Knights gathered around him to defend his standard and have done so ever since. On the other side of the court was another knight, Friedrich Hayek. Friedrich Hayek wrote a book in 1974 called The Mirage of Social Justice. It was, or was read as, an unmitigated attack on social justice and a defense of the ideal of market society. Through the years, an elaborate tale was spun. People had to choose between economic freedom and market society, capitalism, or social justice, democracy, and a sincere concern for the least well-off among us. This great debate, I think of as some of you know, as like a frozen sea, with one camp, the social justice camp on one side, and the other camp, the free market camp on the other. And between those two camps, a stiff wind blows, so that no real communication between the camps can occur. That story that I just told you about the origins and structure of the dispute between the advocates of social justice and the advocates of free markets is not only unfortunate, it is also an exegetical fairy tale. I recently came across a letter written in 1965 in sort of scratchy handwriting by Friedrich Hayek. It was written by Hayek from Freiburg to his friend James Buchanan, another great lion of the free market side and like Hayek, a Nobel Prize winner. In that letter, Hayek begins by saying, you know, Jim, you and I share an interest in studying the ideas that might provide a foundation for the free society. And then, remarkably, Hayek writes, quote, "The only modern philosopher from whom I have received some help in this is John Rawls of MIT." Close quote. Rawls was in the first year assistant professor at MIT at the time. 3 weeks later, Buchanan wrote back to Hayek. He typed his letter. And he said, quote, Buchanan said, quote, "I agree on the work of Rawls. He is doing the most interesting work in philosophy, and I hope that he may have some impact." Well, what's going on? Hayek in his letter to Rawls recommends, Hayek in his letter to Buchanan recommends the first one of Rawls's first articles, an article, a very technical article, in which Rawls talks about an abstract question: what is social justice a property of? So if you have a metric of social justice, Rawls was asking, what is the thing to which we apply the metric to deem whether it's just or unjust? One answer, Rawls says, the wrong answer, is that justice is the property of particular distributions, where you can take a snapshot of society, see who has what, where, what the distribution is, and judge that as just or unjust, and therefore correct it in the nature of social justice. Instead, Rawls says, in that technical article, which became the foundation of all his work, he never changed from that idea throughout his whole career. Instead, he said, Rawls said, the proper subject of social justice is the basic structure of society viewed as an integrated whole. Some panelists this morning were talking about how there's a tendency to see the market and the state as two separate things. Rawls, like Hayek, recognized that in fact they were an integrated thing, that there are government rules that set constraints on markets by defining property rights and more. But the subject of justice is the whole structure of institutions viewed as they tend to operate over time. That idea is something that possible connection between an affinity between defenders of free markets like Hayek and defenders of social justice like Rawls is something that I've been working on now for a few years and with a growing number of friends who I'm trying to convert to a kind of hybrid fusionist approach to justice that I call market democratic. Some people call us bleeding heart libertarians, which I don't like, but apparently sells a lot of t-shirts. I call it market democracy. And the main idea of market democracy is to seek ways to combine a commitment to economic liberty and market freedoms with a sincere commitment to social justice. But now, finally, what about Catholicism and capitalism? There's an idea deep within the Rawlsian schema that some of you probably already know. His main idea, when you get back from all the technical stuff, is this. It's a very simple idea. You can have inequalities in the society, and that society can count as fair. So you can live among a set of social institutions that predictably generate inequalities, and that social system can be completely fair so long as, this is the important part, so long as the society works in such a way that the least well-off people do as well as they possibly could, that the least well-off people do better than they could in any other system. That is called a prioritarian conception of justice. So if you imagine two societies, let me put this down, if you imagine two societies, one very equal, one very unequal, and we ask in Rawlsian terms, which of these two societies is more fair, which of them is more just, which of them better respects our commitment to care for all our fellow citizens as best as possible. The Rawlsian, one's very equal, right, and one's very unequal. Rawls says we must give priority to the least well off and their concerns. So, if I may channel Margaret Thatcher for a moment, watch my thumbs. Rawls says we should look at the least well off and give them a special place. And you can see in this little setup that in this case at least, the least well off are doing better than they would be in this society. Therefore, this society, although unequal, is more fair than this society. You can see where this is going. That idea about a prioritarian conception of social justice sounds a lot like, or at least picks up elements of, the Catholic idea of the preferential option for the poor. It picks up in secular terms the idea that God loves the poor in a special way, and that those of us who care about social justice have reasons to think about institutions, not just distributions, and ask ourselves hard and honest questions about what sets of institutions are most likely over time to do the best for the least well off. There's much more that could be said about what it means to do the best for the least well off if people are cut off and living lives of individualism and isolation, as Patrick worries that happens in a capitalist society, that might not be doing the best for them. But I just want to point you to this. I want to share this thought with you, that great battle in between the political philosopher camps is actually a figment. In fact, those philosophers had very much in common. In the book on the Mirage of Social Justice, Hayek begins the book and ends the book with these footnotes saying, none of this is a criticism of Rawls,
which has baffled Hayek scholars for years, but it's pretty obvious why he agrees with that. Hayek, like Rawls, thinks we have to ask ourselves hard questions about the whole structure, whether evolved or planned, and ask questions about its justice. If we ask those questions about a market society, I think, and give a prioritarian twist to the evaluation, we might see reasons to reconcile the Catholic concern for the poor and a commitment to market society. Thanks. Oops, my everything.
Thank you, John. Now we'll hear from Jim.
Can you hear that?
No.
I can't hear it. Is that working now?
Yeah, keep talking, he'll adjust it.
Mine's working. Why is mine?
Somebody used your name Jim earlier. Do you prefer James?
His name is James, not Jim, just to be clear.
So it's not that'd be vulgar. Right.
It's been made in noble origin.
Okay. It's familiarity, yeah.
We'll enjoy it.
Yeah, exactly.
How's that?
Is
that working yet? No.
I want to count.
Yeah, count to 10.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
This one's working. What? Yeah, you have my argument if you use this one.
And how's that? I'm on. Okay, thank you. Well, I'd just like to begin by apologizing that I'm not actually wearing any cufflinks. And for an Englishman, this is deeply shaming. But my little pink baubles, I left in a gray TSA tray in Charlottesville Airport. And so if at some point during the talk you see a little flap of white, I apologize for that. I have been living in America for 18 months, but I have been, I've lived here before. I went to Yale, I lived in California and in Ohio as well. And my daughter was born, my first daughter, Connie Mae Mumford, was born here. So I have a huge affinity for America. When I started writing about America for different magazines and was, you know, veering towards the satirical, my father-in-law sent me an email and said, beware of the Piers Morgan fate, you know, and of slagging off America and then people turning around and going, well, why are you here then, you know? So I want to be very careful in my talk this evening, in my short remarks this evening. I am, as Card said, neither an American nor a Catholic, but sympathetic to both. I thought I'd try and come at the outsider's angle by just turning briefly to Chesterton, who was English, a writer, an Anglican, and then a convert to Catholicism, age 48. And I am English, a writer, an Anglican, and I've got 13 years left. My purpose in doing this is not only to talk about Chesterton, it's not only to promote British interests abroad, and it's also because Chesterton is just so quotable that I can just basically give you a few quotes and stop, and it'll be a wonderful talk. But no, it is actually to sound a note of hope, and to come at this question by saying that American capitalism and Catholic social teaching are not in principle incompatible, but what I do think is desperately needed at the moment is vision. Following Rerum Novarum, Chesterton's distributist project tried to chart a middle course, note my deliberate avoidance of third way, between laissez-faire capitalism on the one side and state socialism on the other. And the problem with the former laissez-faire capitalism, he was writing 10 years after the Russian Revolution, was that, quote, the practical tendency of all trade and business today is towards big commercial combinations, often more imperial, more impersonal, more international than many a communist commonwealth. And then the alternative, Chesterton said brilliantly, I think, the point about communism is that it only reforms the pickpocket by forbidding pockets. Instead, Chesterton picked up and ran with what we might call the Lockean strain in Rerum Novarum, the emphasis on the natural integrity of private property. For Chesterton, ownership is a self-evident good, and therefore it shouldn't be abolished, it should be distributed. Similarly, profit is a good thing. In fact, too good not to be shared. And accordingly, what Chesterton took issue was, in the current defense of capitalism, was that it was a defense of keeping most men in wage dependence, keeping most men without capital. Now, this conviction compelled Chesterton, as you know, to lambast big business, which backfired when a big newsstand chain didn't publish his own newspaper, GK's Weekly. It led him to monitor and oppose big mergers, to advocate independent proprietorship, to pronounce on every possible occasion that small is beautiful. Come off it, though, I hear you say to me. What possible relevance can distributism have in globalized 21st century economies? Economies where self-employment makes up so small a proportion of overall employment, in economies that produce complex, specialized goods from iPhones to aircraft. Well, I think the vision is beautiful, and I think the vision is doable. But I think what we need above all is for the energy in this room and for the vision and the expression of Roman Catholic social teaching, which was distributism, to really capture the hearts and the minds of the business community. And if there's one thing I haven't heard talked enough about at this amazing conference, one of the best conferences I've ever been to, by the way, just to avoid the Piers Morgan fate, is that what we have to do is we have to convince our friends who are either your parishioners or who are in your churches that there is a different way of doing business. I think we could envisage in our time a radical increase in the rate of self-employment, by which I mean, proportionately, a small increase. Small, but significant. And this is the exciting thing, because many of the industries that lend themselves to self-employment, bike shops, cleaning, landscape gardening, building trades, are entry level. And this is work that my wife did at the Prince's Trust in England, a charity which I'm sure that you know about, Prince Charles's charity. And I think we need this on a far greater scale. And how it's gonna happen, I think it's going to happen by the kind of interventions of people in the business community, giving their time and their energy to mentor the young, the disadvantaged, those coming out of criminal justice system, the long-term unemployed, and giving them the confidence to set up their own productive, profit-making businesses. Earlier, someone said that the best thing women and men in the business community could do for the poor is to start companies. Absolutely, but what Chesterton would say is to start companies that the poor have a stake in from the very start. So that's the first vision. Let me just conclude my remarks by saying what I think is needed to flesh out just to the other half of this vision. Interestingly, as Notre Dame's J. Corrin, that's how it's spelled, by the way, J. Corrin notes in his excellent book, Catholic Intellectuals and the Challenge of Democracy, Chesterton's promotion of ownership and concomitant dismissal of wage dependence led in the general strike of 1926 to him actually criticizing the trade union proposals for a higher living wage because he didn't believe in wage dependence. But I think he was running so far with the Lockean strand of Rerum Novarum at this point that he'd lost sight of the other emphasis and the living wage. And I think that in terms of what Patrick's talked about and the low wage economy, why is it that the simplest words one can't mouth in public? I can do the complicated ones very well. But I think that what we have to do and the prerogative that we have is to ensure that the poor have a floor and that they have a ceiling. The floor is the living wage, and the ceiling is a cap on interest rates for the credit offered by usurious lenders. And we've seen the Archbishop of Canterbury in London working incredibly hard and successfully on this with a company called Wonga. Let me finish. In the UK, two recent political attempts to respond to Catholic social teaching have been Philip Blond's Red Toryism, focusing more on the distributist vision, and then in the Labour camp, the blue Labour thinker, Lord Glassman, who is a Jewish political philosopher. And on the BBC radio, he described Roman Catholic social teaching as a precious gift the church had given to the world. And as a community organizer, Glassman is adamantly anti-statist. He insists only by lobbying companies one by one and bringing their management into direct relationship with the low-paid staff that change and the living wage should be campaigned for. I think, in closing, in Monty Python's Life of Brian, one hearer of the Sermon on the Mount says, "Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the meek. It's the meek who are the problem." And I think that the most moving thing about being at this conference is seeing the passionate and shared refusal to accept that view. But in America today, from what I can see, we have our work cut out. We have the highest incarceration rate per capita in the world, and so visiting Christ there will be taxing. In a country where drug use is so pervasive that it would seem that opium is the opium of the people. And I see, which I see every week at the homeless shelter that I work in and I volunteer at, addiction recovery has to form part of the church's ministry. And those are things for us to do. But when it comes to sharing ownership, and when it comes to campaigning for a floor and for a ceiling, I think that work depends and the response to Catholic social teaching depends upon the engagement to a far greater extent of business leaders who are Christian and who are Catholic. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Hadley, please.
Well, in the Monty, does this work?
Yep.
In the Monty Python version of Life of Brian, what did he say on the Mount? I think he said the cheesemaker shall inherit the earth.
Yeah.
I took that crack about cufflinks as directed to me. And I'd simply invoke Oscar Wilde's line that I compensate for being overdressed by being overeducated. Now, I thought I'd take as the epigraph for this talk, actually that scene in The Importance of Being Earnest when Miss Prism is speaking to Cecily, and she says, "In my absence, I want you to read your primer on political economy, but omit that chapter on the fall of the rupee. It's altogether too sensational for a young lady." Even these metallic questions have their morbid aspects, right? Now, Jim Stoner thinks he knows all my tricks. He thinks I'm going to use an old device and compress this talk Hebraically by omitting the vowels. But I want to just take things at the root in another way. So forgive me for taking things back to the root. In this way, Andrew Bailey is a distinguished professor of computer science at Williams College. But when he was growing up in my neighborhood in Amherst, the son of a professor of mathematics and a dear friend, he gave us a kind of Lockean moment, as Randall Smith would recognize. He had a business mowing lawns for the summer with the ambition of buying at the end of the summer a spiffy bike, an English racer. He did. He made enough money. But he bought the bike, and at the last day of his summer vacation, someone stole that bike. Now, as Locke would say, the thief had appropriated to himself all of Andy's labor for that summer. He had made Andy into his slave. As Locke said, people would have a claim to the fruits of that labor done with their own hands, but that in turn depended on the prior premise that they were the owners of their own hands. They would not have that claim, say, if they were owned as property by other people, as slaves. So think of Lincoln's line, "That black woman may not be my social and intellectual evil, but in her right to eat the bread she has earned through the work of her own hands, she is my equal and the equal of any man." Locke would say that she mixes her labor with her work. John Paul II improved upon this. He said, "No, man engages his freedom, his imagination, his wit, to take these instruments and make them into to fit purposes of its own. After all, the moral agent is the only being who can impart a moral purpose to inanimate matter. And Leo XIII put the same accent when he said that a man who engages in remunerative labor, for him to do that, the impelling reason is to obtain property and thereafter to hold it as his very own. And that move springs from the deepest inclinations of human nature to sustain oneself and one's family. It's a species of natural right, he said. He said the socialists would transfer the property to the collective, and that would strike at the very interest of the wage earner, because it would deprive him of his liberty to dispose of his wages, to dispose of his resources, and to better his own condition. So with Locke, that natural right to property began with the ownership of ourselves, of our bodies. But that is a moral claim, and it's quite different from those who invoke my ownership of my body as the ground for abortion. We're dealing with a moral agent, and a moral agent understands that he cannot coherently claim a right to do wrong. He understands that things he may not rightly claim, even in his standing as a free man and the owner of his own body. He has no right to will his own self-murder. There are moral limits to what we may do, even with our own rights of property. Now, those so-called laissez-faire judges at the end of the 19th century, the early 20th century, began with a clear sense of the moral ground of property, and they had a very precise sense of the moral limits to the uses of those property. Those laissez-faire judges would sustain virtually any piece of legislation carrying a plausible connection to the health and welfare of the community. They recognized, as Pius XI said, that people have to absorb, respect limits to their own property. The judges, those judges in the American founders, never used this term, capitalism. They spoke simply of the system of liberty and the way people made their livings simply provided one notable domain in which that freedom was exercised with legal and moral restraints. Now, the notable exponents of the free market, Adam Smith, Edmund Burke, assumed that the law would ever have to be in place to do the things that the law must ever and distinctly do, to mark off the perimeter of the legitimate and the illegitimate, the perimeter of a decent, of those decent choices that a decent people could rightly make in what they demanded and supplied. Whether prostitution and pornography would be available in the economy would not depend simply on whether people were willing to demand and supply those services in the marketplace. Which is to say, again, that a free economy was simply based on the same moral ground and operated within the same moral framework and constraints as any other domain of our freedom. John Paul II saw all the good things in a free economy, lifting the standard of living. What he warned against was a capitalism that could detach itself from a framework of juridical constraints, which at its core is ethical and religious. And in that respect, you say he was quite in accord with those laissez-faire judges and the exponents of the classical economics, and they came to it under the moral sciences. Adam Smith did his big book on moral sentiments. Now, that classic understanding was probably nowhere expressed with more dramatic force than in that proclamation that was issued among all people by Louis XVI of France, in a proclamation written by the famous Henri-Robert Jacques Turgot, his finance minister, sweeping away all the guilds and monopolies. And in a fine statement, he said, this right of ordinary people to make their living at an ordinary cost is not a royal privilege to be purchased from the monarch. It is a species, he said, of inalienable rights, of natural rights, not simply the product of the positive law. Now, during our own Great Depression, the curious thing is we found people backing into the very things that the classical economists and Turgot and Louis XVI were dismantling, but doing it in the name of high-flying sentiments. My favorite case, drawn from a case I found in the papers of Senator Borah, involved Jacob Maggid, 49 years old, a tailor in Jersey City who was fined $100 in 1934 money, sentenced to 3 months in jail, his wife and three daughters having to take over the business in his absence. And what had he done? Deliberately, he had pressed a suit for his customer for only 35 cents instead of the 40 cents mandated under the National Recovery Act. And Jacob, Abe Traubach said, of the Cleaners and Dyers Board said, it's about time we clamped down on these chiselers and get the whole New York region into line. It was a scheme to prop up the income of people by creating councils of businessmen and unions armed with the powers of law to punish anyone like Jacob Margin who thought he could make money only by working longer hours or working for a little less. People forget that those parts of the New Deal that the courts put away. Yeah. And all done in the name of progressive theories. And we ask, but by the way, on this corporatism, we found people attracted to this not only on the left, but Pius XI drawn to it, this kind of corporatism. But he also recognized that this couldn't function well without legal powers, and as soon as we had legal powers, then the state would be involved, and the interests of the states would displace the interests of the workers. But my question is, this not the story that's told over and again, bearing out the warnings of Leo XIII, that the schemes are offered under the banner of high-flown sentiments, seeking to deliver men from want and solve the problem of distribution, only to remove or burden the freedom of ordinary people to make their livings at ordinary callings like braiding hair, shining shoes, or in New York, driving people from the subways and a gypsy taxi service, subways to their house for a buck until that's put down by the unions. And very recently, we've had this bizarre turn in Milwaukee, Seattle, LA, with some unions pressing to raise the minimum wage to $15, add a mandate for sick leave, and then offer successfully to the employers to sign a contract in which the employer would be released from those terms of the law if they would deduct union dues from the salaries of the employees and deliver these people to a union that they not had themselves chosen. What's an old story? John Paul II raised this question. He said, the preferred option of the church for poverty, for the poor, should not be reduced simply to material poverty. It's been a concern for spiritual and moral impoverishment. So if John Paul II said, we have a choice between a society of capital goods and a society of the human person. It makes a profound difference if we see the human person at the center of it. Because in the old axial order, you need life before you can have liberty. You need liberty before you can acquire property. And as soon as we see the central problem as the problem of the human person, then he says the issue that rises foremost of all these rights is that right to life and that right of the child in the womb to survive. And as soon as we see that as a central issue, it ascends in rights over the question of the minimum wage or the distribution of property. So I put the question to my liberal friends. I said, are you concerned about unemployment? Of all the unemployed? Everyone? You don't know them all. Even those you don't know their deserts. Why are you concerned? They're all human. Oh, if it's human, why aren't you concerned for the 1 million humans every year who are dismembered or poisoned in abortions? Why don't those lives count? Well, John Paul, to put the question, is what is the doctrine of the church on the economy and the social question? He said it reduces to this: the care of that man, the only creature that God willed for its own sake. It's the care of that man, not abstract man, but this concrete, historical man. That man is the path by which the church fulfills its mission and makes its way through redemption and the incarnation. And that is, this is the sole purpose of the church in its social teaching. And I'd say that is a doctrine or a teaching of sufficient depth and sufficient reach to say everything that the church needs say about capitalism or about anything else.
Thank you very much. Those are three, four.
I was going to say which one.
There was four very rich interventions, and I want this to be loose and unstructured as far as it goes, but I would like to encourage an exchange, if I might, and you can take my invitation or not, Hadley and Patrick. Both of you agree on the fact that the human person has to be at the center of all of our considerations, and it's the alienation of the human person, the atomized sort of notion of radical individualism, the person as will, disconnected, no unchosen obligations and so on, that drives the problems that both of you are deeply concerned about and have written about. But it seems like you all may have a disagreement about John Locke. And I'd like to hear that fleshed out a little bit, if you like. But it's your prerogative. If you don't want to take that bait.
Well,
go ahead.
I would take one other angle and ask, because as a colleague of mine would say, Patrick and I are in heated agreement.
I disagree.
I see through your trick. Actually, we're talking about this earlier. This movement to outsourcing and to the impersonal. You and I were talking about this earlier. It's Tocqueville. We have a decision. Are we going to take our aged parents into our home, or we put them in some impersonal institution? Remember, Tocqueville had that line. Remember, he said, I was thought it was funny when I heard that 1,000 people had signed, in America had signed a petition for temperance. Like, why couldn't these people agree simply to sip water quietly by their own fireside? And I realized they're just taking a stand on this public issue. But he said, if the same thing had happened in France, 100,000 people would have separately memorialized the government to keep a watch on the public taverns. The Americans take some, they do things. And I think the old concern was, as we make these decisions, do we take our grandparents into our homes, or do we put them into an impersonal institution, over time, we become a different people. And so, Patrick and I were talking about this earlier. I'm not sure this can be attributed to capitalism so much as the extension of our concern for security and the welfare state. As we seek to make life more and more secure and protect people from the hazards of life, we are then moving to precisely those trends of outsourcing, moving to impersonal institutions, rather than taking responsibility, as George Eliot would say, for what comes within our reach.
Let Patrick respond, and then John, you jump in.
Well, specifically to Carter's question, and I think by way of response to Hadley, I agree completely that this impulse to put away those of us for whom we might be thought to have obligations to care for changes us and it shapes us. But I would press the point that I think not only our economy, but we could say broadly a whole set of social institutions, our deepest political, philosophical commitments, the way in which we arrange social and even increasingly familial arrangements, is a realization of the kernel of a philosophy for whom I would identify Locke as one of its major proponents, and which raises a real problem for Americans, in as much as Locke is often argued to be America's philosopher, which is the realization of a society in which we are liberated from any arbitrary, unchosen relationship. At the heart of Locke's philosophy, we could say liberal philosophy, is the ideal that any unchosen, involuntary bond or relationship is illegitimate. Any bond or obligation that we ourselves did not choose is no longer can be accorded a kind of legal or even a recognized status. Now, we all know that we're not born into any situation. The first thing, when a child becomes conscious that they disagree with their parents, they'll say, I wish I'd never been born, and then I wish I'd never been born to you. And we recognize how ridiculous that claim is. And yet that's in some ways the first kind of Lockean announcement I wish I could have had it otherwise. But what we have done is really institutionalize the capacity of people to live their lives as if they were Lockean individuals. And you know, in a way, this, this example of desiring security is a real interesting example of this. And I use this example not to recommend this in some ways this alternative, but it's a useful heuristic. In the recent debate over healthcare and the healthcare debate, what we tended to see was a debate between one side which argued that market-based solutions to insurance would be the best. If we simply allowed a free market of individual choice, market-based solutions of health insurance, that would be the best solution to our health insurance problems. And the other side, which argued that we really needed a kind of government-insured single-payer system to best accord with the needs of individuals. What's interesting, and I just raise again, I'm not recommending we all go out and do this, but there's a remarkable book called The Dismal Science by a man named Stephen Marglin, who's a Harvard economist, who notes that in old Amish orders, there's actually a prohibition against insurance of any kind. There's a prohibition against insurance of any kind. This is one of the technologies that they don't like, along with automobiles and zippers. that they regard insurance as a form of organization that damages human community. And it damages it in the following way. What insurance does, whether it's provided by the state or by the market, is it allows us to live in a completely anonymous, depersonalized set of relationship with the rest of society. So that we can all be part of an insurance pool and cover each other's risks, the dangers of living in life, and never have to know anyone else who is in that particular pool. And the Amish regard this as a very dangerous and indeed a decisively destructive instrument that undermines the form of community that they seek to lead, which is that if you run into an inevitable catastrophe or problems or dangers, fire burns down your house or you lose a parent, it's the job of the community to make you whole. It's the job of your people to make you whole, to rebuild that house, to take care of the children who for the family who've lost those children. Now, I'm not suggesting we should simply get rid of insurance as a society, but the fact that we regard the only options for thinking about how to take care of risk of our, in our society as either provided by the market or by the state, and not even considering ways that we might think about how do we create conditions in which you will want to take care of your parents as they get old, and not simply chuck them down to Florida to be taken care of in some anonymous healthcare or health facility. It seems to be an option we don't even consider because our attraction is to anonymized, separated relationships, whether it's the state or the market.
John, you want to get in here?
Yeah, so I was so struck before when Patrick talked about the anonymous and heedless forms of relations, and I'm very sympathetic to many of the concerns you have about that. But it just struck me listening to you that economists and classical liberals often think of the markets, the anonymity of markets, in exactly the opposite way. And they see a very positive valence to the anonymity of markets. There's a Greek word, kataloto, which means to exchange. But like most Greek words, it has deeper meanings, further meanings. And kataloto means exchange, but it also means to bring together, or getting closer still, to change from an enemy into a friend. And the idea of anonymity, the positive aspect of market-based anonymity, is that markets allow people who do not share ends together, who are not brought together under some harness of some unified moral conception of solidarity, it allows the anonymity of markets, allows people to become friends, to improve each other's lot in the world, often without even knowing each other. That seems a really important and extremely powerful tool that we should care about in a world of such dramatic inequality and poverty that we live in now. Now, does giving that up mean we move to a world where we care about each other directly in on an unmediated way? I don't think so. I think the trick is to try to understand how can we see the importance of anonymity and mechanisms of anonymity that allow people to mutually benefit one another while still making space in the social world for us to care for one another personally as well. So the anonymity of markets has a very positive side, and I think it's worth keeping it in mind.
James, would you like to jump in?
Yeah, just to switch the conversation back to Hadley's remarks, I'd be interested in knowing, it seems like the way you understand the the message of the Catholic Church to society, which including the economy, is a zero-sum game, that there's only space for... Is that true that you feel that the life message is more important and drowns out other messages that you might find in, say, in Leo the 13th's emphasis on the, you know, a floor and a ceiling? I mean, do you think that those are important things that were part of Catholic social teaching and that should be part of the message to the world as well?
No, I think you simply take this as the central point. It matters profoundly that if you begin with the notion of what is so important about that human person, why the taking of a life is so important, mm-hmm. why restricting the freedom is so grave in a person who can have a moral purpose, who can reflect about the grounds of his own well-being. Everything I've said here is perfectly consistent with the understanding of those moral ends. For example, to meet with Pat, we can understand that whether someone has a right, whether a quadriplegic can find a job for himself in the marketplace should not be the measure of his fitness to live. We as a society will make judgments about that, about rescuing people in certain conditions who cannot afford for themselves. And we've made those things will depend on the generosity of the people. We have to make decisions on whether we're going to fund a system of higher education for the people of New York, and whether we're going to admit resident aliens to this, or whether we'd rather use the money simply to give tax rebates to people. We're making decisions of this kind all the time. Mm-hmm. And it depends in part on the generosity, but I think there are principles that are quite in play to tell us. See, our tort law over the last 100 years has been enlarged with the recognition that the capacity to affect the outcome may confer a certain responsibility. Did you have the means of doing something about it? If you didn't, did you have some good reasons for holding back? And with that, we've not only expanded our responsibilities as a country, we've also expanded the reach of the law. Mm-hmm. I mean, at the turn of the last century, if a woman collapsed in your department store, what you had to do is simply walk around her, not touch her. I didn't put her there, right? But don't ask me to move the train to get that to that body. Why should I take the expense? We've expanded all of this. And all this is perfectly consistent with Leo's understanding about a proper provision made, at the same time understanding that these are moral agents, people who can reflect about the grounds of their well-being. They also can reflect about the well-being of others and would commit themselves to the well-being of others. So we just have to justify in different cases what we think we could impose on people as obligations. But I think we can bring forth good reasons when we've made those extensions.
We can open up to general questions, but you all can continue to examine one another's views and engage in dialogue and exchange. I was told there would be some, is there a microphone down there? I was told there would be a microphone with a cord down there. Do we have it? With a cord, okay, great. So if you come to that microphone, go ahead, Martin, you can begin.
Yeah. My question comes from the German background, and I recall that Hayek, together with the protagonists of Catholic social teaching, are at the basis of what we call the Renanian capitalism, which is not capitalism in the American sense, but a capitalism which Patrick may be heading towards. I'm not sure, but so now it's gone. Am I back? But it was mentioned here that the market democracy, you mentioned the market democracy. My question is market democracy something that could be seen as similar to the German social market economy? And if that is so, Hayek was part of the game and not opposed. He was part of the team that constructed this.
Please.
So are you thinking of ordo-liberalism?
Yes.
So for people who don't know, that there's some market advocates, especially orthodox libertarians, they say things like, market outcomes define social justice. Robert Nozick, for example, said something like that. People have their rights, then they exchange with one another. So long as the exchanges are not coercive, whatever comes out of that process is consecrated by the fact that they were rights respecting. The market democratic approach that I've been working with rejects that idea. We think, along with people like Rawls, strangely enough still for me, that there's a process-independent standard of evaluation that we can work out to understand what it would mean to respect one another in a well-functioning society. And that process-independent standard is a standard of evaluation, here's the twist, that markets may be able to meet. So you might say markets define social justice, and then reject that argument and therefore reject markets, but that's too fast. If you think that there is, as the ordo-liberals thought, a process-independent conception of, say, social justice, as we might call it now, then it's an open question. What system best can match that, the requirements of social justice? I think, along with people like Lord Acton and many others, Adam Smith too, I think, that a market-based society can do well for the least well-off. And where there is this really hard question that several of us have mentioned, you know, what does it mean, what's the standard of measure? What's the metric of the good, the bundle of the thing that we think human beings need to live well? But I think it's really important to recognize how important the economic dimension of that is.
It's
extremely important not to overlook the fact of people starving to death all over the world. That's an economic issue.
James would like to respond as well.
Can I just ask you, John, about that? Because in terms of the comparative rules in case, the history of communism in the 20th century, you know, makes us sort of always answer that question about which system are the poor better off in? Well, obviously in the unequal society where the houses look different, but the poor are doing better off. And in some ways that then throws off an imagining of well, my question is, do you then think that the poor are well off in America, and do you have to answer that question by comparing it with the most tragic cases of the 20th century?
Yeah, so I think your point, so are the poor well off in America? I think your point about incarceration is just, you know, an extremely important piece of data with respect to that question. And I think the fact that America incarcerates so many of our citizens, and often in a racially biased way, is a sign that those incarceration is an experience of poverty, on many dimensions of poverty. So I think the poor are not well off in America. But it's interesting, and I think it was Patrick who mentioned the economist Tyler Cowen. Tyler wrote a piece a couple months ago about global market, the marketization of places like India and China that have been mentioned at a few panels. And what Tyler says, though, is that if you look at the last 20 years, 20 or 30 years, especially as India sort of started moving in a liberalizing direction, we've seen the greatest reduction of inequality that the world has ever seen. That we are living in an era, even with we're talking about inequality in our societies, but we're living within an era in the world which has never seen anything like the degree of reduction of inequality that we've seen. And I know people worry about what are the conditions which led to those changes of a position of great inequality to a position of lesser inequality. But it's really significant, I think, that process is happening and that markets are playing a role. Impersonal markets are playing a role in it. Doesn't mean their souls are saved, but it means they don't die. And it means they have a chance, perhaps, to think about other questions.
But this has been, Patrick, did you want to jump?
Yeah, actually I did.
Go ahead.
Alistair McIntyre the other day noted that roughly the past 40 years, economic growth in America has not led to a reduction of inequality. There's been measurable wage stagnation among the, particularly the lower middle classes and the lower class. At the same time, there's continued to be, in some cases, robust economic growth. Mm-hmm. And if one thinks about it, roughly 40 years ago or so is roughly the time when major corporations and businesses begin the process of outsourcing, from this area among others, outsourcing manufacturing, but not only manufacturing jobs, to places like India, China, et cetera. So we shouldn't be surprised to see a remarkable rise of incomes in those areas as low wage labor markets, and to see at the same time a stagnation of wages along with continuing growth in the United States. What Cowan argues, however, in his book, and this book Average is Over, is we are moving toward a point where we will reach equilibrium in the world labor market. And where producers and various kinds of industries will go is toward automation. Roboticization, and computers really doing a lot more of the work, which means that the world coming into being is a lot like the one Kurt Vonnegut predicted in his 1952 book, Player Piano, where you have a small percentage of the workforce that's doing interesting jobs, and you have most of the rest of the workforce, half of whom are digging holes and half of whom are filling them in and being paid by the government. And that's really the world that Tyler Cowen describes coming into being, which leads to the question, what is an economy for? In the end, what is an economy? What is it supposed to do? An economy, I'll use another Greek word here, economy means oikos nomos. It's the law of the household.
Yeah.
It's the law that governs lives of people within families. Good. How is our economy doing when we measure it and when we bring to bear measures of family health in our society today? Good. And there we see a remarkable bifurcation, where it's not only the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer, but the rich are getting richer in terms of their capacity to form families, right, stable families, right, and the poor getting poorer in terms of their ability to form stable families. Yeah. So as part of, I think, the issues that Hadley would rightly raise, questions about moral values relating to family, relating to life, relating to a host of these kinds of questions, we Catholics have to stop the typical American desire to treat family values and moral questions as questions that are separate, mm-hmm, from economic questions. Because it's quite clear, if it's not clear already, it's quite clear that these are fundamentally related and fundamentally connected, and to begin thinking of economics in its original sense of the term as the law of the household, and in what ways is it supporting the lives of people no matter their capacity to function and succeed in our economic society.
I think it's a fantastic point, and I think that, again, economics, oikos, right, household, with the idea of the shared ends. And it's interesting to think about these two different conceptions, perhaps, you and I are attracted to in slightly different ways, perhaps, of kataloto, of impersonal exchange, which is attractive in part because it does not require a sharing of ends, with this other conception, economy, which is a richer, home-based, to some degree, ends-based sharing conception of interaction. And I'm not sure what's it, but it's those two things are both at play in our world, and I'm not sure what to make of them.
Hadley?
Well, where to cut into?
Can you bring your,
Where to cut into this? Yes, economics and moral judgments are connected, but precisely the way the classical economists understood these things, that you wouldn't be achieving these ends without attentiveness to what you're destroying and what you're violating. I mean, look, you thought a while ago the classic case of Mrs. Blackwood came up a couple of months ago. She had access to a therapy for her cancer that was working. Obamacare quadrupled her payments, and she is not allowed access any longer to that therapy. Now, you come along and say, you're doing this for a public good. You have the best of intentions. But don't you see that what you've contrived here has put us in a position where a woman can't get access to a procedure necessary to preserve her own life and that she's willing to pay for herself? I think you've got to be attentive to so many places where what we do is quite destructive, and we achieve these ends at this time of doing something quite wrong. Now, one place, we can look at those cases I mentioned, because we could see where people are struggling and could need some further help. I don't think I can extract this from a list of what the distribution of income is. Those people are changing. People are moving on up. If you told me, here's somebody who makes $250,000, and here's somebody who's making only $10,000, I can't tell from that that the one person gained it unjustly, and this person deserves it. The Rolling Stones used to go to Yankee Stadium, and in the course of that night, there was a massive transfer of property. That's most amazing. Of those people were, the Rolling Stones were making what most of those people would not have made in 5 years. People weren't objecting. It was they did it because they wanted to do it. But from that, that income distribution itself, I wouldn't draw any inferences about these things. I'd respond to it in the cases you and I have talked about. I see a need and I say, what is it? Why should the society tolerate somebody in this kind of medical condition who doesn't need help? What can we do to provide that help? Not, instead of drawing these things, these inferences from some statistical table.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question from the audience. Yes.
Just
speak loudly.
So, I think there's a pretty good chance I'm on the only Mennonite in the room.
There's always at least two. There's one.
Yay! Well done.
You knew. You knew.
No, I didn't. I just want to say that the situation with the Amherst and the health insurance is actually pretty complicated. When you start looking at how Mennonites try to do mutual aid and the way that collapsed into insurance. So if anybody wants to talk about it, I tell you that. The question I have separate. One is, you're talking a lot about Locke, for instance. Where does someone like Bacon play into all this, especially with the way he was moving to automation and control? And then the little instance of moving parents and the aging into separate entities, how much is that tied to an economy that needs really cheap labor in abundance?
And mobility.
And so what you, right, so you need abundant cheap labor, and if people are going to stay home, you're going to have a lot less cheap, abundant labor. So it makes sense to move them into institutions, right?
I think it's directed to you.
Thanks for you.
Sure. Well, I think there's a pretty clear line and set of relationships between the thought of Bacon, the thought of Hobbes. Hobbes was Bacon's secretary, the thought of Locke. And the deepest connection is really that you see in the early modern period an effort to redefine the human relationship to nature. And Bacon is really at the heart of this, along with Hobbes, along with Locke, which is that the human relationship to nature, which in a pre-modern Aristotelian Thomistic world, is that the effort of human beings to understand nature includes and doesn't disallow or doesn't in some ways separate the effort to understand the ways that human nature conforms to and is a part of the created natural order. And what Bacon really introduces, and I think Hobbes as well, is the way in which our understanding of human nature requires us to understand the fulfillment of our nature in opposition to the created order, to the natural world. And in particular, through the application of science and technologized science to the fulfillment of human will, wants and desires. And so part of what underlies our form of economy is that it exists to allow us to pursue the fulfillment of what is regarded as our nature, which is the desire for power after power that ceaseth only in death, the desire for the unlimited acquisition of goods, experiences, et cetera, requires an economy that will continuously allow that pursuit to take place, what Locke describes in his chapter called Of Power as the pursuit of happiness, without ever achieving it, right? Unlike Aristotle, who says the aim of life should be to achieve happiness, to achieve eudaimonia, and that the pursuit of happiness is deeply linked then to the way in which we shape and form our economic system. Where the interesting side of the story comes in is that the Baconian impulse is ultimately turned inward into human nature itself, which is that the true and ultimate form of control of nature is not only the control of nature out there through our technology, but the control of human nature through technology, through developments in biotechnology, etc. And again, we see a classical case in which we tend to see the left is on the side of controlling human nature, and the right is on the side of allowing human nature while dominating the natural world. But these are flip sides of the same coin. And here again, it seems to me that for Christians, Mennonites, Catholics, etc., we need to, I think, really understand at the root of this modern impulse to conquer nature, whether the nature of the world or the nature of us, is really a fundamentally mistaken understanding of the human anthropology. So there's my little Bacon Hobbes Locke lecture.
In 2 minutes.
That was helpful. St. John's College Great Books Curriculum, which I talked about earlier, is structured in a way that at the end of the sophomore year, you read Descartes and Bacon. You spend a long time with Aristotle, a long time with Plato, the Bible, Anselm Aquinas, Augustine. And all of a sudden, you read Descartes and Bacon, and you feel like something horrible just happened, but you can't quite say what it was.
Something happened there.
And then the rest of the next 2 years after that is figured out how to say what it is. All right, well, that was wonderful. Thank you all so much for your generosity in joining us. Thank you for your attention. And we'll see you next year at the 16th annual Fall Conference. Thank you.